وأن هذا صراطي مستقيما فاتبعوه ولا تتبعوا السبل فتفرق بكم عن سبيله ذلكم وصاكم به لعلكم تتقون.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وسلم تسليما كثيرا. أما بعد، all praise due to Allah, we praise Him abundantly the way He deserves to be praised. We ask Allah to exalt the mention and grant peace and send His blessings and salutations upon our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Brothers and sisters in faith, welcome to another episode or session of our weekly Aqeedah class, Sharh al-Aqeedah al-Wasitiyah, li Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah alayhi rahmatullah. Today we initiate a new chapter or a new discussion on Sifatul Afwi wal Maghfirati wal Rahmati wal Izzati wal Qudrati, the attributes of pardon, forgiveness, mercy, honor, and power. In the Sharh, the Shaykh says, ذكر المؤلف رحمه الله أربع آيات في صفة العفو والقدرة والمغفرة والرحمة والعزة. The author cited four different ayat to prove and affirm those particular qualities of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. الآية الأولى, the first ayah, في العفو والقدرة. It's in regards to pardoning and power. قوله إن تبدو خيرا أو تخفوه أو تعفو عن سوء فإن الله كان عفوا قديرا. Whether you disclose a good deed or conceal it or pardon an evil, verily Allah is عفوا قديرا. He is pardoning and all powerful. الشيخ says رحمه الله يعني إن تفعل خيرا فتبدوه, meaning if you do good and so therefore you're disclosing it, أي تظهروه للناس, meaning you make it public to the people, أو تخفوه يعني عن الناس, or you conceal it from the people, فإن الله تعالى يعلمه. Either way Allah عز وجل is aware of it, Allah knows about it. ولا يخفى عليه شيء, and nothing is hidden from him سبحانه وتعالى. In the other ayah, وفي الآية الثانية, أن تبدو شيئا أو تخفوه فإن الله كان بكل شيء عليما. Whether you reveal anything or conceal it, verily Allah is knower of everything. وَهَذَا أَعَمُّ. The Shaykh said this one is even more general. يَشْمَلُ الْخَيْرَ وَالشَّرَ وَمَا لَيْسَ بِخَيْرٍ وَلَا شَرٍ. It includes the good and the evil and what is considered to be neither good nor evil. وَلِكُلِّ آيَةٍ مَكَانَهَا وَمُنَاسَبَتِهَا لِمَنْ تَأَمَّلَ. And each ayah has its own relevance and its context for those who reflect. وقوله أو تعفو عن سوء. العفو هو التجاوز عن العقوبة. Or if you pardon an evil. The Sheikh said, pardon is to overlook the punishment. If someone is deserving of a punishment and you overlook that punishment, this is called عفو. فإذا أساء إليك إنسان فعفوت عنه فإن الله سبحانه وتعالى يعلم ذلك. If a person harms you and you pardon him, then Allah عز وجل is well aware of that. ولكن العفو يشترط للثناء على فعله أن يكون مقرونا بالإصلاح. However, for pardoning to be praiseworthy, for the doer, for the pardoner to be praised, it is a condition that it should be associated with rectification. لقوله تعالى فمن عفا وأصلح فأجره على الله. Because Allah says, whosoever pardons and makes reconciliation, then his reward is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وذلك أن العفو قد يكون سببا للزيادة في الطغيان والعدوان. And this is because sometimes pardoning people will be a reason for them to increase in transgression and and oppression. وقد يكون سببا للانتهاء عن ذلك. Or it could be a reason to desist from that. وقد لا يزيد المعتدي ولا ينقص. And it could be that if you pardon someone, he will neither do more nor do less. Meaning there are three situations. If you pardon someone, it could be an invitation for them to continue to transgress, or it could be a reason for them, if you pardon them, to desist from transgression, or it could be somewhere in between. It will neither make him stop nor will it make him go further. The Sheikh says, فإذا كان سببا للزيادة في الطغيان كان العفو هنا مذموما. كان العفو هنا مذموما. If pardoning a person will be a reason for them to increase in transgression, then pardoning in that context is blameworthy. وربما يكون ممنوعا, and perhaps it could be prohibited that you pardon someone. مثل أن نعفو عن هذا المجرم, such as if we were to pardon ex-criminal. ونعلم أو يغلب على الظن, and we know or we most likely we think أنه يذهب فيجرم إجراما أكبر, that he will go and continue to transgress and do even a greater crime. فهنا لا يمدح العافي عنه بل يذم. Here the person pardoning is not to be praised, rather to be criticized. And I would like to connect this with some of the comments that some of the people leave on my Facebook channel. I know the fundamental principle is that we want to be kind and forgiving to the people. And if you read my replies in general to the people, you'll find that they're actually divided into the same categories. You will see that there will be times when I reply to the transgressor with kindness and good words and advice. And there are times where I'm neutral, and there are times where I don't let someone get away with the nonsense that they spew on my channel. And I believe, wallahu a'lam, that I'm following this particular methodology that I learned from this particular book and from the fundamental principles of Islam. You don't always get to get away with your transgression. And it's not right that every time someone transgresses against you that you forgive them. We have many examples for that from the Quran and the Sunnah. And it's enough to say that this is not Christianity where you're told to turn the other cheek. I will not turn the other cheek, and no one should turn the other cheek. If you're going to come to someone's channel and talk nonsense, then you will be put in your place so that you no longer go on other people's channels and talk nonsense. When someone humiliates you in public, then next time you go get excited with your keyboard warrior skills, you will hold back a little bit, say, you know what, man, maybe that's not exactly the best. Let me word it better. Let me try to be nicer. Many people come on my channel and advise me. I have no problem accepting advice from the smallest and the youngest to the oldest and the most senior. I don't have a problem accepting advice from anyone if you're really giving advice. If you're really sincere, if you're respectful, wallah, I will take the advice on board. I mean, I'm full of mistakes and full of errors, and I would love to fix myself. I would love to improve myself. But you're going to come and talk smack, you know, agent getting paid by the government in order to do that. Whoa, 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 buddy. Hey, man, slow your roll, baby. Ain't nobody paying my salary except the company I work for, man. Nobody giving me a lick, not even a penny, not even a dollar. I'm not affiliated with any government or any entity of any sort. I give da'wah for the sake of Allah, people. So when you come and want to insinuate that I'm some sort of agent of some sort, and you think you can go around anyone who goes to Salafiyah, you just call them agents who are working for X government or Y government, then you will be put in your place, homeboy. So next time you want to run your mouth, you shut up. And then I remind them that I will be your contender on Yawm al-Qiyamah before Allah. Guess what? I want to forgive you, but you need to slow your roll. And some people who don't understand any better, we will give them the benefit of the doubt and give them some kind words. So the bottom line is, what I'm saying is, don't, sometimes you criticize me, say, brother, you should be nicer. Yes, jazakumullah khair. Yes, there are times where I could have been nicer, and there are times where this is exactly the kind of retaliation that the person is asking for. It's one of my favorite expressions in the world. It's modern, it's slick, and it's funny. You play stupid games, you win stupid prizes. It doesn't get any clearer than this. You wanna be, you know, the transgressor, then you will be educated and perhaps insulted in a manner equal to your initial insult, which is allowed in Islam. Which is allowed in Islam. As for forgiveness, then inshallah ta'ala on Yawm al-Qiyamah, hopefully we all forgive each other and we all pardon each other. But until then, I'm not going to let you transgress, because if I let you do so, then you will continue to behave in this manner, and this is haram. And if I were to forgive you, I would be blameworthy as well, as per the statement of the Sheikh. Now there's the other occasion. وَقَدْ يَكُونُ الْعَفُوُ سَبَبًا لِلْإِنْتِهَاءِ عَنِ الْعُدْوَانِ. It could be that pardoning someone is a reason for them to stop hostility. بحيث يخجل, where in he becomes shy, ويقول هذا الذي عفى عني لا يمكن أن أعتدي عليه مرة أخرى. He will say, this person that I've transgressed against, there's no way I'm going to violate him one more time. ولا على أحد غيره, nor will I violate anyone else because he pardoned you. فيخجل أن يكون هو من المعتدين. So he becomes shy to become among those who transgress. وهذا الرجل من العافين. And this person then falls into those who are pardoners. فالعفو هنا محمود ومطلوب. So pardoning in this context is commendable and required. وقد يكون واجبا, rather it could reach the point of being compulsory. It could reach the point of being compulsory. بسم الله. ثالثا, وقد يكون العفو لا يؤثر لا ازديادا ولا نقصا فهو افضل, لقوله تعالى وان تعفو اقرب للتقوى. There are situations where the pardoning may not affect neither increase nor decrease the transgression. In this case, pardoning is still better because Allah Azza wa Jalla says, and if you pardon, then that is nearer to piety and the fear of Allah. وهنا يقول تعالى او تعفو عن سوء فان الله كان عفوا قديرا. Or if you pardon an evil, then verily Allah is عفو and قدير. يعني إذا عفوتم عن السوء عفى الله عنكم. Meaning if you pardon the evil, Allah will pardon you. ويؤخذ هذا الحكم من الجواب. How do we get this ruling? We deduce that from the answer. Because the answer says, فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ عَفُوًا قَدِيرًا. يعني فيعفو عنكم مع قدرته على الانتقام منكم وجمع الله هنا بين عفو والقدير. Wait. Meaning Allah Azza wa Jal will pardon you in spite of his ability to take revenge from you. And here Allah Azza wa Jal brought a relation between عفو and قدرة. Pardoning and power. لأن كمال العفو أن يكون عن قدرة. Because the perfection of pardoning is when it comes associated with power. أما العفو الذي يكون عن عجز فهذا لا يمدح فاعله. As for the one who pardons because of inability, then you're not praised for that. لأنه عاجز عن الأخذ بالثار, because he's unable to take revenge. وأما العفو الذي لا يكون مع قدرة فقد يمدح, لكنه ليس عفوا كاملا. And as for the pardoning that is not associated with power, it could be praiseworthy, but it is not the perfect type of pardoning. بل العفو الكامل ما كان عن قدرة. So the ultimate type of pardoning is when you do so when you're able to do something about it, but you don't. Not that you're a small guy. And this big old guy comes and smacks you. And you look at him, say, look, man, I forgive you, bro. I forgive you, bro. And you're really forgiving him because there's nothing that you can do about it. So you're not really being, that's not the type of pardoning that is praiseworthy per se. That's just you being, being compromised. But if you're the big guy and you could knock someone out and then you pardon them, now we're talking about good stuff and good stuff. تمام. ولهذا جمع الله تعالى بين هذين اسمين العفو والقدير. That's why Allah Azza wa Jal brought a relation between those two. He combined those two names, which is the pardoner and the powerful. فالعفو هو المتجاوز عن سيئات عباده. So the pardoner is the one who overlooks the sins of his slaves. والغالب أن العفو يكون عن ترك الواجبات. And most likely, or in most context, pardoning is associated with when a person leaves off obligatory acts, when a person abandons obligatory acts. والمغفرة عن فعل المحرمات, whereas مغفرة, forgiveness, is associated with the commission of prohibited acts. So when Allah Azza wa Jal pardons, meaning when you don't do an obligation, Allah pardons you. When you commit a sin, then Allah Azza wa Jal forgives you. والقدير, it's an important distinction, by the way. والقدير ذو القدرة, and the قدير is the one who possesses power. وهي صفة يتمكن بها الفاعل من الفعل بدون العجز. And it's an attribute wherein the doer can do whatever he wants without any incapability. وهذان الاسمان يتضمنان صفتين. Those two names, they combine or they bring about or they contain two qualities, two attributes. وهما العفو والقدرة. And those are the attributes of pardoning and power. الآية الثانية, the second ayah, في المغفرة والرحمة, in regards to forgiveness and mercy. قوله وليعفوا وليصفحوا ألا تحبون أن يغفر الله لكم والله غفور رحيم. Let them pardon and forgive. Do you not love that Allah should forgive you? And Allah is the all forgiving, most merciful. Do you guys know the context of this ayah? How many of you know the context of this ayah? Not that many, huh? هذه الآية نزلت في أبي بكر رضي الله عنه وذلك أن مصطح ابن أثاثة رضي الله عنه كان ابن خالة أبي بكر وكان ممن تكلموا في الإفك. This ayah was revealed concerning Abu Bakr, may Allah be pleased with him. And that is مصطح ابن أثاثة was, what do you call him? He was his second cousin. He was Abu Bakr's second cousin from his maternal aunt. And he was among those who spread the rumors about the slander against Aisha. What is the slander story about Aisha? وقصة الإفك أن قوم من المنافقين تكلموا في عرض عائشة رضي الله عنها. That a group of hypocrites had spoken about the honor of our mother Aisha. May Allah be pleased with her. وليس والله قصدهم عائشة. And their intention was not Aisha. لكن قصدهم رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. But their intention was to actually insult the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. أن يدنسوا فراشة. That they wanted to يعني basically cause confusion concerning his bed, meaning his family. وأن يلحقوه العار والعياذ بالله. And that they wanted to humiliate him and cause humiliation to him, and we seek refuge with Allah. ولكن الله ولله الحمد فضحهم. However, Allah and all praises due to him exposed them. وقال والذي تولى كبره منهم له عذاب عظيم. And as for him among them who had the greatest share therein, he will have a great torment. تكلموا فيها. They spoke about her. وكان أكثر من تكلم فيها المنافقون. And the most who spoke about her were the hypocrites. وتكلم فيها نفر من الصحابة رضي الله عنهم معروفون بالصلاح. But also a group of righteous companions also got involved in speaking about her. ومنهم مصطح بن أثاثة. Among them were مصطح. فلما تكلم فيها. When he spoke about her, وكان هذا من أكبر القطيعة. يعني قطيعة الرحم. This was among the greatest types of severing the kinship ties. أن يتكلم إنسان في قريبه بما يخدش كرامته. That you should speak about a relative of yours in regards to that which will affect his honor. لا سيما وأن ذلك في أم المؤمنين زوجة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. Specifically when this is in regards to the mother of the believers and the wife of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. أقسم أبو بكر أن لا ينفق عليه. Abu Bakr used to spend money on him, the مصطح. He swore by Allah that he will no longer spend on him. وكان أبو بكر هو الذي ينفق عليه. He swore by Allah that he will no longer spend on him. And you know the story of Aisha when she was left behind and she dropped her bracelet, she was looking for it, and then she fell asleep over there. One of the Sahaba found her after the caravan had moved on, and he never even spoke to her. He recognized her, he moved for her so she could be on the mount, and he took her back to the camp. So when she came back, they were making stories about her having been with the Sahabi. And of course, who does that? Who are the people who are filthy and sick like that? And who represents the biggest type of hypocrites today? The Shia. Who else dares to speak about Umm al-Mu'mineen Aisha except the Shia? Ya akhi, Allah al-Azim, we're living at a strange times. How can someone be so confused and misguided about the deen of Allah? How can someone try to reconcile and make relations and friendship with the Shia? When wallah, I'm out of words, man. إِلَى اللَّهِ الْمُشْتَكَى وَعَلَيْهِ تُكْلَانِ عَلَى كُلِّ حَالٍ فَقَالَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى ولا يأت لأولو الفضل منكم والسعة أن يؤتوا أولي القربى والمساكين والمهاجرين في سبيل الله. الله عز وجل says in regards to that. And let not those among you who are blessed with graces and wealth swear not to give any sort of help to their kinsmen, the poor and those who left their homes for Allah's cause. وكل هذه الأوصاف ثابتة في حق مصطح. All of these descriptions apply to مصطح. فهو قريب ومسكين ومهاجر. He was a relative, he was a poor person, and he was a migrator. Then Allah said, وَلْيَعْفُوا وَلْيَصْفَحُوا. Let them then pardon and forgive. أَلَا تُحِبُّونَ يَغْفِرَ اللَّهَ لَكُمْ يَغْفِرَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ غَفُورَ رَحِيمٌ. Do you not love that Allah should forgive you? And Allah is the all-forgiving, most merciful. فَقَالَ أَبُو بَكْرَ رَضَى عَنْهُ بَلَى وَاللَّهُ. Abu Bakr replied by saying, yes, by Allah. نحن نحب أن يغفر الله لنا. We would love that Allah would pardon us. فرد عليه النفقة. So then he started to spend on him again. Then Abu Bakr returned the spending on مصطح. هذا هو ما نزلت في الآية. This is the context of the revelation of this ayah. Excuse me. أما تفسيرها فقوله وليعفوا وليصفحوا، اللام لام الأمر وسكنت لأنها أتت بعد الواو، ولام الأمر تسكن إذا وقعت بعد الواو. طيب this is a lot of grammar, so we will skip that and we'll go straight to the point. قوله وليعفو يعني يتجاوز عن الأخذ بالذنب. So يعفو meaning overlook the sin committed against them. وليصفحوا يعني يعرضوا عن هذا الأمر. And يصفحوا meaning let them ignore, let them turn away from the whole matter, ignore the whole matter. ولا لا يتكلموا فيه, don't even discuss the matter anymore. مأخوذ من صفحة العنق وهي جانبها. And it's taken from the word صفحة العنق, which is the side of the neck. لأن الإنسان إذا أعرض فالذي يبدو منه صفحة العنق. Because when a person turns away, what you see is the side of his neck. So this is where the word يصفحوا comes from, meaning when you turn away, خلاص, you're not concerned about the subject matter anymore. صفحة العنق. والفرق بين العفو والصفح أن الإنسان قد يعفو ولا يصفح. The difference now between عفو and صفح is that a person might pardon but not forgive. بل يذكر هذا, meaning he will not turn away from it. بل يذكر هذا العدوان وهذه الإساءة. He will always remember this transgression and this hurt, this harm. لكنه لا يأخذ بالذنب. But he will not retaliate for the transgression. فالصفح أبلغ من مجرد العفو. So if you were to actually over turn away from the whole thing, that's actually greater than merely pardoning. Meaning I could pardon you, as in I don't hold you accountable for your transgression against me, but I'm storing this in my data, in my database. So in my database, I remember. So whenever there's another occasion, I'm going to go to my archive and I'm going to pull out this incident and even maybe make mention of it. Whereas صفح is after you pardon, you forget about the whole issue. It's like it never happened. And you can see how difficult it is to be at that level. Hey. وقوله ألا تحبون أن يغفر الله لكم ألا للعرض. Meaning this is an offer from Allah Azza wa Jal. Do you not love that Allah should pardon you? والجواب, and the answer, بلى نحب ذلك. Of course we would love that. فإذا كنا نحب أن يغفر الله لنا فلنتعرض لأسباب المغفرة. If we truly love that Allah Azza wa Jal forgive us, then let us expose ourselves to the things which will bring about Allah's forgiveness. ثم قال والله غفور رحيم. غفور هذه إما أن تكون اسم فاعل المبالغة وإما أن تكون صفة مشبهة. Again, we're going to skip the grammar. I know y'all love grammar, but grammar is going to distract us from the main subject. And the Sheikh, rahimahullah, used to love to delve into grammatical things. If you really want to get on the grammar point, you should get the sharh of Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen of Al-Ajrumiyyah. He has a sharh of Kitab Al-Ajrumiyyah, which is, I'm not going to say advanced, but it's, يعني intermediate grammar book, where obviously the whole book is about that. Now, regardless, the Sheikh said, what we're focused on is that Ghafoor is an indication that Allah Azza wa Jal often forgives. It's about the abundance and repetitiveness of forgiveness. وَقَوْلُهُ رَحِيمٌ هَذَا أَيْضًا اسم فعل. Again, the Sheikh is going to get into the grammar. And the bottom line is that all of them have to do with for the abundance of forgiveness and showing mercy. على كل حال أنت رحمتي أرحم بك ما شاء. الآية الثالثة في العزة وفي قوله ولله العزة ولرسوله وللمؤمنين. Now we're going to discuss the quality of might. And the saying of Allah Azza wa Jal, but عزة belongs to Allah, His Messenger, and to the believers. This is in Surah Al-Munafiqun. This ayah was revealed in retaliation to the statement of the munafiqeen, لَإِنْ رَجَعْنَا إِلَى الْمَدِينَةِ لَيُخْرِجَنَّ الْأَعَزُّ مِنْهَا الْأَذَلِ. The hypocrites have said, if we return to Medina, indeed the more honorable will expel the meaner. Huh? يُرِيدُونَ أَنَّهُمْ الْأَعَزُّ. They meant to say that they are the ones who are honored. وَأَنَّ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صلى الله عليه وسلم والمؤمنين الأذلون. And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and the companions are the humiliated ones. فبين الله تعالى أنه لا عزة لهم. الله عز وجل highlighted that they have no honor. فضلاً عن أن يكونوا هم الأعزون, let alone them being more honorable. They don't even have any honor to be more honorable than the Messenger of Allah. وأن العزة لله ولرسول المؤمنين, and that the true honor belongs strictly to Allah, His messengers, and the believers. ومقتضى قول المنافقين أن الرسول عليه الصلاة والسلام صلى الله على آله وسلم والمؤمنين هم الذين يخرجون المنافقين لأنهم أهل العزة والمنافقين أهل الذلة. And the bottom line of the statement of the hypocrites that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and the Sahaba, they will be the ones who will take out the hypocrites, and that they are the people of عزة, and the hypocrites are the people of humiliation. ولهذا كانوا يحسبون كل صيحة عليهم. That's why they used to think anytime any kind of revelation would come would be against them. وذلك لذلهم وهلعهم. That's why, because they were in a perpetual state of being of panicking and being humiliated. وكانوا إذا لقوا الذين آمنوا قالوا آمنا. They were so bad that whenever they would see the believers, they would say to them آمنا خوفا وجبنا, out of fear and cowardice. وإذا خلوا إلى شياطينهم, but whenever they would be alone with their شياطين, قالوا إن معكم إنما نحن مستهزئون. They will say to them, we are with you, we are only mocking. وهذا غاية الذل, and this is the utmost humiliation. أما المؤمنون, as for the believers, فكانوا أعزاء بدينهم. They were honored with their religion. قال الله تعالى, قال الله عنهم في مجادلة أهل الكتاب. Allah says in the context of debating with the people of the book, فإن تولوا فقولوا اشهدوا بأن مسلمون. So if they turn away, say, bear witness that we are Muslims. فَيُعْلِنُونَهَا صَرِيحًا. They announce it clearly. لَا يَخَافُونَ فِي اللَّهِ لَوْمَةَ لَائِمٍ. They do not fear in Allah the criticizing of the critics. Excuse me. وفي هذه الآية الكريمة إثبات العزة لله سبحانه وتعالى. And this noble ayah, we have the affirmation of the izzah or the honor for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Excuse me. وذكر أهل العلم أن العزة تنقسم إلى ثلاثة أقسام. عزة القدر وعزة القهر وعزة الامتناع. So the scholars say that this honor is divided into three categories in regards to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The عزة of power and the عزة of what is it? The izza of power, the izza of force, and the izza of protection. The izza of power, the izza of force, and the izza of protection. فَعِزَّةُ الْقَدْرِ معناه أن الله تعالى ذو قدر عزيز يعني لا نظير له. So the first one is that Allah عز وجل is the possessor of the mighty power that has no equivalence. It has absolutely no equivalence. وَعِزَّةُ الْقَهْرِ هي عِزَّةُ الْغَلَبَةِ. As for the izza of force, it is the izzah of dominance. يعني أنه غالب كل شيء. That Allah Azza wa Jal is dominating and subjugating everything. قاهر كل شيء. Allah Azza wa Jal, everything is dominated by Him. ومنه قوله تعالى فقال أكفلنيها وعزني في الخطاب. And He said, hand it over to me, and He overpowered me in speech. يعني غلبني في الخطاب. Meaning He overpowered me, overcome me in the speech. فالله سبحانه وتعالى عزيز لا غالب له بل هو غالب كل شيء. الله عز وجل is the almighty and nothing can overcome him, rather he overwhelms and overcomes everything. And the third one, وعزة الامتناع, which is the protection, the عزة of protection, وهي أن الله تعالى يمتنع أن يناله سوء أو نقص. That Allah عز وجل, it is impossible that he is afflicted with harm or deficiency. فهو مأخوذ من القوة والصلابة. And this is derived from strength and might. ومنه قولهم أرض عزاز يعني قوية شديدة. So this is why they say that this kind of earth is عزاز, because it is strong and solid. It's extremely strong and solid. هذه معاني العزة التي أثبتها الله تعالى نفسه. These are the types or the meanings of عزة which Allah has affirmed for himself. وهي تدل على كمال قهره وسلطانه. And all of them reflect and indicate the perfection of Allah's dominance and His dominion. وعلى كمال صفاته and the perfection of his attributes وعلى تمام تنزهه عن النقص and the perfection of Allah's absolute freedom from any type of imperfection تدل على كمال قهره وسلطانه في عزة القهر. So it is indicating the perfection of Allah's dominance in his power or his izza, his might of dominance. وعلى تمام صفاته وكماله وأنه لا مثيل لها في عزة القدر. And that the perfection of his attributes and that it has no equivalent when we speak about the izza of qadr, which is the power, the might of power. وعلى تمام تنزهه عن العيب والنقص في عزة الامتناع and how perfect Allah عز وجل in being above any imperfection and deficiency when we speak about the عزة of امتناع or protection. قوله ولرسوله وللمؤمنين يعني أن الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم له عزة وللمؤمنين أيضا عزة وغلبة meaning the messenger of Allah also has honor and the believers have also honor and dominance. Aha, pay attention now. ولكن يجب أن نعلم أن العزة التي أثبتها الله لرسوله وللمؤمنين ليست كعزة الله. We have to know that the honor that Allah has affirmed for His Messenger and the believers is unlike the might of Allah. فإن عزة الرسول عليه الصلاة والسلام والمؤمنين قد يشوبها ذلة. The might of the Messenger of Allah and the believers might be afflicted with some sort of weakness. It could be overcome with some weakness. لقوله تعالى, because Allah says, وَلَقَدْ نَصَرَكُمُ اللَّهُ بِبَدْرٍ وَأَنْتُمْ أَذِلَّ. Because Allah Azza wa Jal says, verily, and Allah has already made you victorious at Badr when you were a weak little force. وَقَدْ يُغْلَبُونَ أَحْيَانًا لِحِكْمَةٍ يُرِيدُهَ اللَّهُ عَزَّ وَجَلْ. Rather, or actually, the believers may even be overcome and defeated for the wisdom that Allah Azza wa Jal wants. فَفِي أُحُدْ نَمْ يَحْصُلْ لَهُمْ تَمَامِ الْعِزَّةِ. In the battle of Uhud, they did not have the ultimate type of might. لِأَنَّهُمْ غُلِبُوا فِي النِّهَايَةِ لِحِكَمٍ عَظِيمَةٍ. Because they were defeated at the end due to some tremendous wisdom. وَكَذَلِكَ فِي حُنَيْنٍ وَلَّوْ مُدْبِرِينَ. Also in the battle of Hunayn, they had turned away on their heels and ran away. وَلَمْ يَبْقَ مَعَ النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ وَسَلَّمْ مِنْ 12,000 إِلَّا نَحْوَ 100 رَجُلٍ. And only 100 people remained with the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam out of 12,000 men. Out of 12,000 soldiers, only 100 men remained with the Messenger of Allah. هذا أيضا فقد للعزة. This is another example of losing or the honor being faded temporary. لكنه مؤقت. It is temporary. أما عزة الله عز وجل فلا يمكن أبدا أن تفقد. As for the might of Allah عز وجل, it may never ever ever diminish or be lost or be compromised. وبهذا عرفنا أن العزة التي أثبتها الله لرسوله وللمؤمنين ليست كالعزة التي أثبتها لنفسه. We learn from this that the might that Allah Azza wa Jal has affirmed for the Messenger and the believers is unequal, is unlike the might that Allah Azza wa Jal has affirmed for himself. Excuse me. وهذا أيضا يمكن أن يؤخذ من القاعدة العامة وهي أنه لا يلزم من اتفاق الاسمين أن يتماثل المسميين أو المسميان ولا من اتفاق الصفتين أن يتماثل الموصوفان. Very important principle I want you to pay attention to and understand. This can also be taken from another general principle we have, that the fact that two things are equal in name, it does not mean that they are equal in essence. Two essences that share a name does not mean that they share their essence. Also, two attributes which can be attributed to something does not mean that those two things that are being described are the same. ولا من اتفاق الصفتين أن يتماثل الموصوفان. If there are two qualities being attributed to something, it doesn't mean that that which they're describing is also equal. So if you say there's a large house and a large car, in both cases you're saying large is a description of these two items, and the fact that large is being used as an adjective to describe the house and the car, does that mean that the house and the car are equal? Absolutely not. You get that? And for the first example, when we have two things that have the same name, it doesn't mean that they are equal. So if you say a car, A car can be a large car, a small car, a sports car, a monster car, a mini car, and the list goes on. The fact that the term car is being used for multiple vehicles also does not mean that those cars are equal. And that's just common sense. But it's important in our context of describe, because we're saying izza. Why is this important? Just so you know, from a fundamental point of view and a linguistic point of view, the fact that we're saying izza belongs to Allah and His Messenger does not mean that because izza is being attributed to Allah and the Messenger, the believer, that izza is equal. It doesn't mean that the ones it's describing are equal, and the fact that their name is being used for all of them does not make them equal either. Kapish? Kapish? Al-ayat al-rabi'a fi al-izzati aydan. It's also regarding izza. وَهِيَ قَوْلِ عَنْ إِبْلِيسِ فَبِعِزَّتِكَ لَأُغْوِيَنَّهُمْ أَجْمَعِينَ. By your might, then I will surely mislead them all. This is the saying of Iblis. Of course, it's in the Quran, but Allah Azza wa Jal is quoting what Iblis said. الْبَاءُ هُنَا لِلْقَسَمُ. So this is the ba' of swear or oath. لَكِنَّهُ اخْتَارَ الْقَسَمُ بِالْعِزَّةِ دُونَ غَيْرِهَا مِنَ الصِّفَاتِ. Why did Iblis choose to make an oath by the might of Allah instead of other qualities? لِأَنَّ الْمَقَامَ مَقَامُ مُغَالَبَةٍ. Because this was the context of one trying to overcome the other. فَكَأَنَّهُ قَالَ. As though he's saying, بِعِزَّتِكَ الَّتِي تَغْلِبُ بِهَا مَنْ سِوَاكَ لَأَغْوِيَنَّ هَؤُلَاءِ وَسَيْطِرْ عَلَيْهِمْ. By your might, with which you're able to overcome everyone else, I'm going to deceive them and control them all. I'm going to deceive them and mislead them and control them all. فَكَأَنَّهُ قَالَ. نعم يعني بني آدم, meaning the children of Adam, حتى يخرجوا من الرشد إلى الغي, until they go out from guidance to the wrong path, until they leave the righteous, the guided path to the wrong path. ويستثنى من هذا عباد الله المخلصون. Exempt from that, exempt from those people that the shaitan will dominate, are the sincere slaves of Allah. فَإِنَّ إِبْلِيسَ لَا يَسْتَطِيعَ أَنْ يَغْوِيَهُمْ. Iblis is unable to deceive them. Iblis is unable to deceive them or mislead them. كَمَا قَالَ تَعَالَى. As Allah Azza wa Jalla says, إِنَّ عِبَادِي لَيْسَ لَكَ عَلَيْهِمْ سُلْطَانٌ. Certainly you shall have no authority over my slaves. فَفِي هَاتَيْنِ الْآيَتَيْنِ إِثْبَاتُ الْعِزَّةِ لِلَّهِ. In these two ayat, we have the affirmation of the izzah for Allah. وفي الآية الثانية إثبات أن الشيطان يقر بصفات الله. And in the second ayah, we have an affirmation that the shaitan himself acknowledges the attributes of Allah. فكيف نجد من بني آدم من ينكر صفات الله أو بعضها. How do we find among the children of Adam those who deny some of the who deny the attributes of Allah, or some of them? أيكون الشيطان أعلم بالله وَأَعْقَلْ مَسْلَكَ مِنْ هَوْلَىٰ النُّفَاتِ. Is it possible that the shaitan is more knowledgeable of Allah and has a more sound path than those deniers who deny the names and attributes of Allah? The shaitan himself said, بِعِزَّتِكَ, by your might. He's acknowledging the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ajib. Hey, I wanted to make a comment about this past year. Yeah. So that means, ya akhwan, if there's anything that we could derive, that we really need to work hard on being among those whom Allah Azza wa Jal has exempted from the shaitan overtaken them by being sincere. Being sincere in the deen of Allah means you do the acts of worship for the sake of Allah alone, and means that you are upon tawheed, upon sound tawheed. Once you compromise those things, then the shaitan will have easy access to you. So let us be wary of that. طيب. ما نستفيده من الناحية المسلكية. What will we benefit in terms of behavioral benefit? What will we attain from a behavioral benefit? في العفو والصفح. In regards to the pardoning and forgiveness, هو أننا إذا علمنا أن الله عفو. If we know that Allah Azza wa Jalla is pardoning, وأنه قدير, that Allah is powerful. أوجب لنا ذلك أن نسأله العفو دائما. We should then therefore ask Allah for pardoning all the time. وأن نرجو منه العفو مهما عما حصل منا من التقصير في الواجب. And that we should seek Allah's pardoning in regards to what we have fallen short in regards to the obligations. And you will remember that in Ramadan, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم taught Aisha, to make the dua for Laylatul Qadr. Allahumma innaka afuun tuhibbu al-afwa fa'fu anni. Notice how many times afu is being highlighted in that particular hadith. أما العزة أيضا نقول إذا علمنا أن الله عزيز, as for عزة, if we know that Allah عز وجل is mighty, فإننا لا يمكن أن نفعل فعلا نحارب الله فيه. We should never then therefore do an act wherein we are waging war against Allah. Wherein we are waging war against Allah. مثلا الإنسان المرابي معاملته مع الله المحاربة. For example, the person involved in riba, his treatment to Allah is one of waging war. Allah says, فَإِنْ لَمْ تَفْعَلُوا فَأَذَنُوا بِحَرْبٍ مِنَ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ. And if you do not do it, meaning if you do not stop from engaging in riba, then take a notice of war from Allah and His Messenger. إِذَا عَلِمْنَا أَنَّ اللَّهَ ذُو عِزَّةٍ لَا يُغْلَبْ. If we know that Allah is full of might and He cannot be overcome, فَإِنَّنَا لَا يُمْكِنُنَا أَن نُخْدِمَ عَلَى مُحَارَبَةِ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ. How is it then we are going to wage war against Allah? How is it that we're going to move forward by waging a war against Allah? قطع الطريق محاربة. Armed robbery is a form of war also. Allah says in the Quran, إِنَّمَا جَزَاءُ الَّذِينَ يُحَارِبُونَ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ وَيَسْعَوْنَ فِي الْأَرْضِ فَسَادًا أَنْ يُقْتَلُوا أَوْ يُصْلَبُوا أَوْ تُقَطَّعَ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَأَرْجُلُهُمْ مِنْ خِلَافٍ أَوْ يُنْفَوْا مِنَ الْأَرْضِ. The recompense of those who wage war against Allah and His Messenger and do mischief in the land is only that they shall be killed or crucified, or their hands and their feet be cut off from opposite sides, or be exiled from the land. فَإِذَا عَلِمْنَا أَنَّ قَطْعَ الطَّرِيقِ مُحَارَبَةَ اللَّهِ. If we know that armed robbery is a form of waging war against Allah, وَأَنَّ الْعِزَّةَ لِلَّهِ, and that the might belongs to Allah, امْتَنَعْنَا عَنْ هَذَا الْعَمَلِ. We will avoid and stay away and refrain from that deed. لِأَنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الْغَالِبُ. Because Allah is the dominant one. Allah is the conquering one. وَيُمْكِنْ أَنْ نَقُولَ فِيهَا فَائِدَةٌ مِنَ النَّحِيَةِ الْمَسْلَكِيَّةِ أَيْضًا وهي أن الإنسان المؤمن ينبغي أن له أن يكون عزيزا في دينه. And another behavioral benefit is that we can say that it's upon the believer that he should seek and exhibit honor in his religion. بحيث لا يذل أمام أحد من الناس كائنا من كان, that he does not allow himself to be humiliated or he doesn't humble himself before anybody no matter who that person is. إلا على المؤمنين, except upon the believers. فيكون عزيزا على الكافرين ذليلا على المؤمنين. So he's always in the state of honor and might in front of the disbelievers, but in the state of humbleness and humility among the believers. And that is very important, yeah, brothers. Of course, in the context of da'wah, it doesn't mean that you, regardless, this does not mean that you become haughty and arrogant, and that you disdain and look down upon people and so on and so forth. But the saying, it's saying that you should have honor in your religion and don't let the culture or the lifestyle of the non-Muslims overwhelm you to the point where you feel shy of your own deen. So for instance, if you have to pray in a public place, you shouldn't be concerned about what the people think and let them affect you. If you have to pray in the middle of the airport, so be it. So be it. Allahu Akbar and pray. In a situation like this where your religion is being compromised, you should be have enough honor and dignity in your religion and don't be overwhelmed by the disbelievers. Tayyib, inshallah, this is perfect that we ended here because this next topic is interesting and it needs its own explanation, which is the discussion on the Ithbatul Ism Lillah. Affirming the name for Allah, affirmation of the name of Allah. But we will leave that till next week, bi-idhnillah azza wa jalla, if we all remain alive and healthy. And we will take some questions right now since we have a good 10-15 minutes, maybe less. So let's see what's going on here. Zakum Allah khair. Hala wallah bi Sheikh Hussain. Ya Hussain, I'm not a Sheikh, and I'm guessing you're not a Sheikh also. Yeah. I like the word brother. I like the word brother. I would love to be your brother in faith. I'm happy with that as a title, wallah. It's much better. Wa alaykum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh wa jazakallahu khayran ya Raj. Oh, there the chat's working. Yes, it is. Mr. Original. وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته. The person with the longest name of a channel. Limited quantity, Sophia expired with no evidence. الله يسامحك يا شيخ. Where did you get this name from, man? That's an essay. Yeah, I don't really reply to emails, yeah, Raj. I don't reply to emails, Habibi. It's too much work. And I hate typing. I hate typing. I'm a speaker. So if you got a question, you're better off sending it to me on WhatsApp so I can send you a voice message, or you can ask me here and I'll be happy to answer. I'm not in the business of replying to emails. I spend half of my life replying to emails, and it pained me so much, and I'm too old right now for that. Maybe we had turned off the chat, Habibi, so that the people won't get distracted during the class. Anyways, it doesn't look like we got anything going on except people just sharing their love. And ahlan wa sahlan wa alaykum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh ya ganiyat Isamuto. Isamoto. Okay. So ask here, ya Raj. Ask while we got time for it, Habibi. Later, I don't guarantee you anything. May I be a lawyer of criminal? No, you may not. No, you may not be a lawyer for a criminal. How are you going to defend the criminal, ya Sheikh? Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. How do I advise my little sister who is still dating? Oppa! Well, she needs to learn Islam from scratch, really. And, you know, she needs to understand the consequences of that. Wow, it's a lot of work you got to do, bro. It's a lot of work you got to do. But you need to be able to sit down with her and have a long conversation with her about, you know, what's halal and what's haram. Instill in her the love of Allah Azza wa Jal and the fear of Allah. That's really what it boils down to. This is where we all have a problem. Our problem is that we don't love Allah enough, we don't fear Allah enough. If we loved Allah enough and we feared Allah enough, we would do much better. But our sad state is that we don't. But if we work on those two things, then we'll be able to overcome any kind of sin. What would be the conditions of giving da'wah to a Shi'i? What if they try to spread their beliefs? Don't. Unless you're highly qualified to engage in a dialogue with the Shi'i, you are not allowed to speak to them about religion. I'm not playing. Wallah al-Azim, I'm not playing. If you are not qualified to debate with the Shi'i, you're not allowed to have a religious conversation with them because it is suicidal. We come live when the class begins, ya Abdul. I hope that you have a Abdul something and Sajid, you're not Abdul Sajid. Because if you're Abdul Sajid, then you're the worshiper of the prostrator. I think you have a different name. Ala kulli hal. The class began 50 minutes ago, Habibi. It's live. It's a live class right now. طيب. The hadith, the son of Adam will keep returning on a sin if I keep falling into a particular sin and try quitting, but then the thought comes that if I quit, I will just fall into another sin. Please explain. I don't know. Wait, what is there to explain? But then the thought comes that if I quit, I will just fall into another sin. Please explain. Okay, well, that's life, bro. You're going to keep falling into sin, repenting from sin, falling into sin, whether it's the same sin, whether it's a different sin, don't get caught up in all the dynamics of it. The underlying fact is we will sin, we should seek repentance from Allah for our sins. And just keep moving, keep moving. What is the best way to teach the deen when homeschooling, when as parent you don't have enough knowledge? By learning. What's stopping you from learning, Captain? What is stopping you from learning Islam on your own so you can teach your children? It's not like you're 150 years old and you've reached a point where you can no longer acquire knowledge. You have the ability to learn. You learn and you teach. Subhanallah, maybe this is an occasion Allah created for you so that you can exert yourself into learning. Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, Mr. Wacko Bear. Wacko Bear, anywhere I go, any video I watch on YouTube, I see you in the comment section. How do you manage, ya Sheikh? Maybe because you're a bear. Or you bear all these difficulties. I think you're the most commonly spread commentator on Salafi videos in the world. Maybe I'm wrong. Assalamu alaikum, brother. Wa alaikum salam. Can I pray in a room or building while a dog is present? I keep a dog in my shop for a security reason and wondering if my prayers are valid. May Allah bless you. Yes, inshallah, there should be no harm. Brother, there's a delay with as the chat was closed for the duration of the lesson. That's fine. So you can have it to wait a little longer for people to post their comments, questions. Understood. Jazakallah khair. Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I've come across material from some Salafi brothers about the sun going around the earth and they claim that all of the Salaf held this view. Is this interpretation of the... It got cut off. Honestly, the issue of the, you know, I'm a literalist in this sense. I don't care about what science has to say at all. I don't care if all the scientists came and swore in front of me that, you know, that this revolves around that or whatever. I go strictly by the Quran. Whatever the Quran says is what I believe. I haven't really looked into the matter of which one. I know there's a discussion among the scholars about which one revolves around which. Is it the sun that's moving or the earth that's moving or whatever, whatever. I don't care. Whatever the Quran teaches, that's my view. What's the conclusion of this lecture in a very simple way? That Allah is full of might and Allah is forgiving and pardoning and He loves that we should forgive and pardon, and that sometimes pardoning people will make them transgress some more, so you shouldn't pardon them. Is it a must to correct people in the masjid if they make mistakes while praying? Yes, if you're able to correct them, you should. I don't know, Ya Raj. Like I told you, I haven't looked into the matter, brother. Forgive me, Habibi. Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullah. Hey. What is this one way to Jannah, bro? Hey. One way to Jannah. Come on, man. I got one way to paradise. You got one way to Jannah. What's up with this? For an Islamic organization that I'm an associate member of, we have to fill out a personal development profile where we log our Quran study, Hadith study, pages of Islamic books read, number of prayers in congregation. We have to show to those above us in the organization. Is this permissible? No, it's not permissible. What the heck is that, man? Should you also tell them how many times you entered the bathroom and how many cheesecakes you ate? What is this, bro? What kind of organization is this, telling the people to expose their deeds that are supposed to be between them and Allah? It's unacceptable, Habibi. Unacceptable. Ustad, is it possible to make these classes slightly later as it starts at 8 a.m. here in the UK? I'm sorry, Wacko Bear. I don't think that's possible right now, Habibi. It's okay, man. Get up early. Early birds. Blessings. There's a blessing. Burika li ummati fi bukuriha. This ummah was blessed in the early morning. Finish the class and go back to sleep. My 9 months old daughter sneezes. I say Alhamdulillah on her behalf since she can't say it. And I tell my other kids to say Alhamdulillah. Do I need to say this or is there bid'ah? Am I encouraging? No, this is fine. You're doing this for teaching purposes. There's no harm in that, inshallah. Can we be friends with people whose aqidah is unknown? Friends? What do you mean by friends? Yeah. And once you know what it is, give them da'wah. I have two questions. There's a group that affirm the names of Allah but negate the attribute connected to the name, such as al-seeing, and negate the quality of sight to Allah. I'm a bit confused. Can you explain this and how to refute this claim? What? We've already discussed this in this book, Ya Abu Aisha. Ya Abu Aisha, go back a few episodes or a few sessions. We discussed this very subject matter. This is deviance because every name is associated with an attribute and we affirm both. We affirm the sight and we affirm that Allah is Basir. That was the discussion literally two sessions ago. Please go back to the old, actually start the book from scratch. Start from the first episode because it's all correlated and connected. It's a gradual buildup for you to get the full picture. So do that, inshallah. Is it wrong to have imtinan in one's heart after doing good to someone and getting oppressed by him as long as it does not show imtinan in action? Yeah, you should fight off that feeling, but if as long as you don't act upon it, you don't say anything about it, then it's all gravy. I heard Ustadh Abu Suhaib may say that it's permissible to have a non-segregation in family gathering as long as there's hijab. No flirting, sexual talk, and no seclusion. What is said about this? I don't know. I'm not familiar with this position. And I don't know who Abu Suhaib is. Is it forbidden to congratulate disbelievers on their marriage? No, it is not. It is not forbidden to congratulate the disbelievers on their marriage. Wa alaykum salam. Should I listen to refutations if I don't know the person being refuted? No, you should not. If the person being refuted is someone that does not concern you, then why listen to it? I mean, usually in the refutation, there are some good principles that are being applied. So if you're trying to learn the principles that the refuter is establishing, which is considered general knowledge, then yes. But if you're doing it for the sake of just entertainment and you're just like people, you know, other people to be refuted, and there's no real beneficial knowledge that you are acquiring from watching, then you shouldn't watch. If you're acquiring beneficial knowledge, then go ahead. What is the meaning of firasa? Firasa is like what we consider, what we say in the English world, a sixth sense. It's your basically your ability to see things with a lot of wisdom and with guidance. Excuse me, with guidance from Allah. It's like being guided by Allah, inspired by Allah to see things beyond what the average people see. Now, is it permissible to make snowmen? I don't know. What I mean, the snowman, does it really look like a creation of Allah? Is it connected with Christmas or something? I don't know. It's a good question. Do you know Sheikh Hafiz Zubair Ali Zayf from Pakistan? No, I've heard of his name. How does one teach their children about sex education and what age? You teach them by explaining to them whatever is in the Quran and the Sunnah and try not to go beyond that. At what age? When they reach the age of discretion where such topics are understandable to them. Okay, we went from no questions to a million questions, mashallah. Can you explain the hadith that the thing will give family news? Is it the mobile? I don't know what you're talking about. Alhamdulillah, I have no idea what you're talking about. That the thigh will give family news? What is your opinion on wearing a thobe in the West? Well, look, if wearing a thobe is going to make you stand out so much and it's going to bring about negative energy and negative vibes, then you shouldn't wear it. You should look like the people. If so many people wear it and it's become normalized and it's acceptable by the local people, they know that, you know, this is your dress code, then it's fine. The idea is that you don't want to stand out. Now, secondly, the Prophet ﷺ, when going up in the heavens, heard the pens scribbling on the paper. How do you reconcile between that and the hadith that the pens have been lifted and the ink is dry? Habibi, that's because the occasion of Al-Isra and Mi'raj has a lot of elements that are extraordinary. From the fact to the fact Prophet ﷺ saw people in the fire being punished for this and being punished for that, while we know that this is something yet to happen. The end of time and the division of people between Jannah and Jahannam and all this happening is something that will happen in the future. However, Allah Azza wa Jal showed the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam elements of that as part of the miraculous nature of the Isra and Mi'raj. So just like everything that happened there was besides the point, then this is one of them, number one. Number two, the fact that the Qadr of Allah Azza wa Jal has been written and concluded does not mean that the angels still don't write down what the deeds of the people are. So there's no contradiction, there's no conflict between the two, because it could be that the Qadr has been written and decreed and the angels still have the scribes have the obligation to write down whatever we're doing. There's no conflict between them for an explanation or reconciliation to be required, because each one stands on its own. Each one stands on its own. Type. How do I respond to someone who attacks the Saudi scholars because they don't speak up on jailing Fulan and Fulan? You respond to them by saying, Habibi, we in Islam, you are not required. I don't understand. I gave a talk about this. Maybe someone can post a link about the rulers. What is your role? What is your role with the rulers? Who said that you have an obligation in Islam to go up and speak about Fulan being in prison or Fulan being in prison? Who said that? And what is the benefit that you will get? That's really the bottom line. When you want to enjoin the good, forbid the evil, you have to be able to establish the good and eliminate the evil. If enjoining the good and forbidding the evil does not bring about the desired result, then you're not allowed to enjoin the good, forbid the evil. And anyone with a little bit of brain should know that if you were to make a big fuss and if you want to publicly go and say, oh, you've imprisoned Fulan, then you go into prison with him. Okay, did you get him released? No. Did you benefit yourself? No. So are you allowed in Islam to enjoin the good and forbid the evil? No. Hello? Like really though? Really though? Who does that? His family, his relatives, senior scholars, people whose word is impactful, people who can actually do a change. If you're going to bring it about on yourself, you're falling into an area of khuruj. You're going against the ruler, and you have a ruling in Islam not to go against the ruler. Even if he's corrupt, even if he's this, even if, as long as they're established in the salah, they're Muslim rulers, and you need to zip it. That's just the way it is. Submit to Allah, ya akhi, and let Allah deal with them on yawm al-qiyamah. Why do you want to involve yourself in fitna? Amazing, subhanAllah. طيب. Assalamu alaikum wa alaikum salam. Can you please make a detailed explanation of making mistakes in salah and how to correct them? Example one, how to make the sajda of forgetfulness if we miss the surah. I think brother Asim al-Hakim has some content on YouTube where he explains all of these things. So I recommend that you refer to it so that we don't, you know, repeat it ourselves. I don't wind up doing something that someone else already did, definitely in a better way than I could. So I know there's something already there, Ya Wahid. Just look it up, inshallah. What is the concept of someone having nur on their face? It's something that is not visible. It's not like a fair skin. Someone who's light skin, they have nur. And someone who's from an African descent, they don't have it. SubhanAllah, it has nothing to do with that. The nur on the face is basically a divine gift that Allah Azza wa Jal gives to the righteous slaves. We ask Allah Azza wa Jal to make us among them. Those who know, meaning the people of Iman, they see the nur in someone's face. It's not something that we could, you know, put a finger on. Naam. Which Islamic science is your expertise? The one I'm discussing with you right now. If I were to say the thing that I'm most comfortable with is aqidah and da'wah ghayr al-muslimin, the invitation of non-Muslims. A form of comparative religion, I would say. Not very deep, but a form of comparative religion and aqidah. Those are my areas, wallahu a'lam. Should I pray? Okay, we've passed the mark of the 1 hour, and we're getting a lot more questions, so please forgive me. I'm going to have to skip those, and perhaps we could postpone them. Bi'idhnillahi azza wa jal, till next week. Forgive me for not being able to answer all of the questions. May Allah bless you all and forgive you and forgive me and forgive all of us. I'll just answer Abu Aisha because that's a typical question from some of our brothers. Who are my teachers? Well, my first teacher was Brother Ahmed al-Kurdi, who gave me some basics, and he guided me to Abu Mujahid Farid Abdullah, the graduate from Al-Imam University in Riyadh. That was in Los Angeles. And I studied with the Sheikh for while I was in the States. Then I moved to the kingdom. When I came to Saudi Arabia, I used to attend the durus of Sheikh Muhammad Bakhtar al-Shinqiti and Sheikh Abu Zayd Makki. Basically, those are really the people that I actually sat with and I studied with on regular basis. But because I'm an Arab, and alhamdulillah, Allah Azza wa Jal blessed me that I know the Arabic language. So that, in my opinion, that gives me access. Once you have the right foundations, I have access to all the works of the scholars. So even though I never studied with Sheikh bin Uthaymeen, I've heard thousands of hours of Sheikh bin Uthaymeen's talks and Sheikh Albani and Sheikh bin Baz rahimahumullah. And I'm able to find the books of these ulama and their fatawa and their, you know, whatever they have there. It's accessible to me. All of these to me are reinforcers. They're reinforcers to the foundation which was built initially by Sheikh Abu Mujahid Farid Abdullah. May Allah bless him. Not a special person in any way, not an outstanding talib ilm. I'm just an average, I might qualify to be a da'i. I will actually label myself a level below being a da'i. I'm more of a public speaker. I'm more of a public speaker. But I try to, you know, I try to do my own research and study before I speak about matters. And you guys are the judges. At the end of the day, I'm not here to boast my PhDs and qualifications and credentials and all this stuff that you hear, subhanAllah, here and there. That's not what it is. The bottom line is, don't judge what I'm saying. If what I'm saying is contradicting the Quran and the Sunnah, you could throw me in the ocean and pretend that I don't exist, and I'll be completely fine with it. If what I'm saying is a manifestation of the teachings of the Quran and the Sunnah according to the way of the Salaf, then that's all that is needed. And that is all what's important. That's all that what matters to me, whether myself or others. Wallahu a'lam. Jazakum Allah khairan. Subhanakallah bihamdik. Shahadu an la ilaha illa ant. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Thanks for watching this video. Subscribe and click on the notification bell. Like, comment, and share with friends and family.